But we're so thankful that you're here. I first wanted to introduce the club for a bit. The Alexander Hamilton Society was founded in 2010 as an independent, nonpartisan, not-for-profit membership organization dedicated to promoting constructive debate on basic principles and contemporary issues in foreign, economic, and national security policy. There are over 50 AHS chapters at colleges across the country and 3 professional chapters in New York, DC, and San Francisco. I also want to thank our co-sponsors, Columbia Student Governing Board and Columbia Law School's National Security Law Program. If you've come to any of our past events, you'll probably notice that this is a bit of an upgrade for us in terms of not only catering. I hope you guys are enjoying the Five Guys, so shout out to Five Guys. But also in terms of venue, this is a law school building that we generally don't get into. This is probably the closest I will ever come to being in law school. So I'm going to enjoy my time here. And right before we get started, I want to talk for a second about the state of international relations today, and more specifically, about the importance of talking about the state of international relations today. A common criticism that you'll see in op-ed pieces or somewhere in the news is that college campuses are becoming ideological bubbles, in the sense that you'll only hear, on many topics, you'll only hear one side of a debate in conversations on campus. And I think that many of you would agree that there's a certain degree of truth about that here on Columbia. But I found that when it comes to many topics related to foreign policy and national security, the bigger problem is not so much that we're only hearing one side of a conversation about these topics, the problem is that we're not having many conversations about these topics in the first place. When you walk around this school, or even when you look around this room, you're seeing future CEOs, you're seeing future lawyers, you're seeing future senators and politicians. And in a few years, it's going to be our generation making decisions about these exact topics that will affect millions of people around the world. But that's why it's disturbing to me that fairly often when I've asked a classmate what they think about the ongoing conflict over the South China Sea, or the ongoing war in Syria, or the North Korean nuclear system, or even the Iran deal, a lot of the times they'll respond to something like, oh, I'm not really paying attention to that, or I don't have time to care about that. Now, I'm not trying to stand up here and shame everyone for not spending all their time scouring the international section of the Times, or the Journal, or the Economist. This is Columbia, and we pride ourselves on being super stressed and super busy. On the topic of stress, keeping up with the news is sometimes an extremely stressful act in itself. I made the mistake the other night while I was up late writing a paper in Butler to use my 20-minute relaxation study break to read an article about our ongoing war in Afghanistan, and let's just say my relaxation break was not very relaxing. But I am saying that these topics are important, and that they matter for everyone. It matters to all of us if Iran gets a nuclear weapon. It also matters to all of us if the policies that we implement cement Iran as a global pariah and cause them to become even more desperate and extreme. My entire point is that we need to talk about it. And on that topic, I want to introduce our speakers who are here to talk about that with us. First off, we have Mrs. Danielle Pletka. She's the Senior Vice President for Foreign and Defense Policy Studies at ADI, where she oversees the Institute's work on foreign and defense issues. She writes regularly on national security matters with a special focus on Iran, the Middle East, Syria, Israel, ISIS, the Arab Spring, and South Asia. Before joining ADI, Pletka was a longtime senior professional staff member for the Senate Committee on Foreign Relations, where she specialized in the Near East and South Asia as the point person on Middle East, Pakistan, India, and Afghanistan. And our other speaker would be Professor David Phillips from here at Columbia. He's the director of our Peace Building and Rights Program at the Institute for the Study of Human Rights here at Columbia. Professor Phillips has worked as a senior advisor to the United Nations Secretariat and as a foreign affairs expert and senior advisor to the U.S. Department of State. He has held positions as a visiting scholar for Harvard's University Center for the Middle East Studies, executive director at Columbia University's International Conflict Resolution Program, director of the Program on Conflict Prevention and Peacebuilding at the American University, associate professor at New York University Department of Politics, and as a professor at the Diplomatic Academy of Vienna. So needless to say, we're going to have a pretty good conversation here. And I want to quickly introduce our moderator, Theo Milanopoulos. He's a PhD student here at Columbia, and he was our moderator at our past event. With no further ado, I want to thank you all for coming again and begin the debate. Thanks.
So what I'm going to do is...
Can you hear me?
There we go. Thank you all for coming. What I'm going to do is just give
a very momentary
setting of, can you hear me?
Yes.
What I'm going to do is set the scene just very briefly for our two speakers before turning to each of them to deliver some opening remarks. And then I've prepared a series of questions to pose to each one of our speakers. I will then, once we've gotten pretty far into the discussion, I'll then open it up to the audience for some questions. Given that we are talking about Iran and its nuclear program, I reserve the right to exercise my nuclear option, which requires that you actually ask a question and that you stay on topic. So just be forewarned, that is how I'm going to conduct the Q&A. But last month, President Trump refused to recertify that Iran was complying with the terms of the 2015 deal freezing Iran's nuclear program, negotiated by the Obama administration and the so-called P5 plus one international partners. The Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action requires Iran to dismantle much of its nuclear weapons program and to submit to intensive inspections in exchange for international sanctions relief. President Trump has variously argued, that the deal is seriously flawed and, quote, an embarrassment, but he stopped short of reimposing sanctions that would have effectively terminated the agreement from the United States' side. He punted the decision to Congress. Both of our speakers today wrote essays in advance of that decision opposing President Trump's option choice, though they wrote it for very different reasons. I'll turn to Mr. Phillips first to give some opening remarks, and then to Ms. Plecka.
Okay, would you like to go first, or should I?
I am completely in the world.
Since you introduced me as the lead speaker, I'll do that.
Go for it.
So this is framed as a debate. My training and temperament is in conflict resolution. I think I may need those skills tonight, seated next to Danielle, who has got some very strongly held views on the topic. But we may also find that we agree on much that's discussed. We probably agree on the fact that there was, or I won't speak for you, I don't think there was any need to negotiate a nuclear deal with Iran. Iran was in its box. Sanctions were working. We heard a lot about the breakout, but it would have taken some months for that to happen. And I don't feel as though we were on the verge of a crisis. When I heard that Deputy Secretary of State Bill Burns had been meeting secretly with Iranian counterparts, I was heartened, because I had worked for Ambassador Burns at the Near Eastern Affairs Bureau. He was an extremely smart, savvy, seasoned diplomat. I was a little less heartened when the negotiations were taken over by John Kerry and Wendy Sherman. I'm in the habit of saying that if you put John and Wendy together, they're half as smart as Javad Zarif, who was Iran's foreign minister and was negotiating on Iran's behalf. Iran would never have entered into this negotiation if it didn't know exactly what it wanted to get out of it. And in my view, Iran created a crisis, created the feeling that they were going to break out and there was an imminent sort of nuclear emergency for the precise reason of getting their assets unfrozen, having sanctions lifted, achieving some domestic political objectives to rehabilitate their economy. I don't think that the negotiations were necessary. Once the negotiations started and there was a deal announced, then we were presented with a little bit of a quandary. How do we respond to the deal? What do we do in reaction to it? Clearly, the JCPOA is a long game. It's designed to establish a process for confidence building between Iran and the international community. It's a bet that after 10 to 15 years, Iran is going to somehow be transformed as a society, that its political leaders are going to be dramatically different than the mullahs that run the country today, and that it would voluntarily choose not to pursue a nuclear weapons program. No accord, especially one with such important consequences, should ever be based on wishful thinking. And in my view, the deal that John Kerry negotiated was full of wishful thinking. It's important that we evaluate what has happened since the deal was made, that we are steely-eyed in assessing its flaws, but we also look at some of the benefits that have resulted downstream. In my view, the Obama administration is so intent on sealing a deal. Remember, the President Obama made a mark to have rapprochement with rogue regimes, and you include Iran in that category, that he ceded some very important concessions to Tehran, including what's called nuclear latency, which means that Iran retained a lot of the infrastructure to develop its nuclear weapons potential in the future. But in the short term, it gave up the immediate capacity to break out and move towards a nuclear weapons program. The flaws of the deal are pretty apparent. The ban on building new heavy water reactors and plutonium reprocessing plants becomes voluntary after 15 years. It was 3 years ago that the deal was made. So 12 years is not a long time in a national history. It's hard to envision that Iran is going to be transformed politically and as a society in such a short amount of time. Iran was not required to dismantle its heavy water processing facility at Iraq. And though Iraq is not active now, it can be restarted and fully operational in 1 or 2 years. Iran was allowed to retain its infrastructure for enriching uranium, which can be expanded to do R&D during the terms, during the life cycle of the deal. And the Natanz centrifuges can restart spinning highly enriched uranium between 2025 and 2030. In 2004, there were 50 high spinning centrifuges. By the time the deal was negotiated, I think there were 20,000. So clearly, Iran had built its infrastructure. They brought the negotiations to a boil in order to achieve some of its primary objectives. It's important to be balanced. This is the conflict resolution side of me speaking. So looking at the deal, I think there are some assets or some advantages. It curtailed Iran's access to the materials necessary to build warheads. It dismantled the plutonium-based pathway to making a nuclear bomb. In perpetuity, the deal prohibits Iran from ever testing a nuclear device or testing a nuclear trigger. If Iran does either of those, the accord provides for snapback multilateral sanctions. Organizing that in practical and diplomatic terms is a different challenge than agreeing to it. But on the paper, there are limitations imposed on Iran's nuclear potential. Today, there are more inspectors in Iran than in any non-nuclear country in the world. And the International Atomic Energy Agency has confirmed that Iran has stopped producing fissile material and has declared facilities, dismantled two-thirds of its active centrifuges, and eliminated 98% of its enriched uranium stock. That's not a bad success record. The benefits to Iran, which is what Rouhani and Zarif wanted from the beginning, were primarily financial. Iran received a variety of benefits. These included the termination of an oil embargo, sanctions relief, political re-engagement with the international community in the United States. The deal facilitated the release of between $100 and $150 billion in frozen Iranian assets. It also reduced the likelihood of military force being used against Iran. You spoke earlier about President Trump's reaction. We all know that during the campaign, he made sport out of disparaging the deal. He called it a stupid loser deal. It's a horrible embarrassment to our country. We did it out of our weakness. I'm sure Daniela is going to respond to that and maybe dispute assertions that are made. By condemning Iran the way that he has, for betraying the spirit of the deal. Trump himself has also betrayed the spirit. And if we're banking on goodwill to be cultivated and for Iran to change, those steps to kill the spirit of the deal going both ways don't help us achieve what we want to in the long term. And when we talk about the spirit of the deal, the Secretary Tillerson, who may not have a job tomorrow, maybe not now, our phones are turned off, so there's no way to know. He has rightfully said that in the preamble, there was an implied understanding that Iran would behave in a positive way, conducive to improved relations in the Middle East. Iran hasn't done any of that. It's continued its threats against Israel. It provides assistance to terror groups like Hezbollah. It's contributed to instability in the Middle East by backing Shiite militias in Iraq, in Yemen, and in Syria. And in violation of a UN Security Council resolution, it's tested its Khorasan Shah missile, demonstrating that it has the capacity to deliver sophisticated weaponry, including a nuclear weapon in the future. Trump decided not to certify on October 15th. It's not clear to me if he did that because it was a campaign promise, but as you said, he pumped it to Congress. He decided not to certify against the advice of his national security counselors. In congressional hearings during that period, Secretary of Defense James Mattis and the National Security Advisor McMaster both publicly went on record saying that the deal exists and they support it. Congress has some windows during which it needs to decide about whether to reimpose sanctions on Iran. There's also an international component that we need to keep in mind, because the deal was not between the United States and Iran. It's not a bilateral agreement. It was done through a consortium of countries. And our European allies have admonished the United States not to decertify or to reimpose sanctions. It doesn't necessarily kill the deal if we do decertify. It would just mean that the deal would continue without the United States a part of it anymore. If the U.S. backs out of the deal, it would further isolate the United States from its allies. We may have a difference of agreement on the Paris Protocol on climate change, but clearly that has polarized the U.S. from the international community in unprecedented fashion. Iran's response to Trump's decertification and his rhetoric has been adamant in opposition to any effort to renegotiate the deal. Zarif has said that he would consider walking away if the U.S. withdraws. Even if the U.S. did withdraw, Iran would probably stay in the deal for a couple of years so it could fully reap the benefits of the agreement. And then it might decide to walk away. So there doesn't seem to be a plan B in the Trump administration about what we do after decertification. If we were able to undermine and scuttle the deal and Iran walked away from it in turn, how would we react to that? And this is where I think Danielle and I are surely going to disagree. I view that as part of a pattern of strategically incoherent foreign policy. So my conflict resolution skills are for naught. It seems as though we agree on much more than we disagree on. But this strategic incoherence to me is extremely worrisome. We talked about betraying the spirit of the accord, that there's no plan B. Trump wants to renegotiate the sunset clauses. I don't see any chance that Iran is going to do that. I don't see any support from the international community. Federica Mogherini has made the position crystal clear. The U.S. is going to be on its own in an effort to try to redefine the deal. I just don't see that happening. If the U.S. withdraws from the deal, it gives Iran license to withdraw itself. Rouhani has actually succeeded in turning the tables on President Trump. Remarkably, Iran, in this instance, looks like the rational actor, abiding by international agreements, whereas in contrast, Trump seems impulsive, emotional, and lacking a coherent national security strategy. I didn't think I'd ever see the day where an Iranian mullah would seem more reasonable than an American president, but it appears increasingly to be so. And Trump's impulsive rhetoric towards Iran is also matched by his baiting of North Korea's Kim Jong-un, who he's called Little Rocket Man and Sick Puppy. I think fundamentally I have no disagreement with Trump's view of Kim Jong-un. I just don't know about the efficacy of calling him out and embarrassing him, particularly that he's such an unpredictable character. Walking away from the Iran deal also sends a message to the regime in North Korea. Ostensibly, we want the North Koreans to negotiate an agreement to eliminate all their nuclear capacity. If Kim is looking at how we're handling the implementation of the Iran deal, he's probably not going to have a lot of confidence in America's commitment to follow through. That makes it even harder to deal with a sick puppy like Kim Jong-un. And when it comes to strategic incoherence, I also want to talk about the events in Iraq and what happened in Kirkuk on October 16th. Just days prior, President Trump had announced a new get-tough strategy on Iran. We were going to tolerate their mischief-making and their support for militias and Shiite proxies in the region. When we withdrew our support from Peshmerga in Kirkuk, we not only threw our best friends in Iraq under the bus, we also allowed the Iraqi army to take control of a northern corridor that runs through Sinjar. And that means that there is now a contiguous territory under Iranian influence, connecting Tehran to Qom, to Baghdad, to Damascus, to Beirut. And why is this significant? This is the corridor that Iran has been using and will continue to use to resupply Hezbollah and Hamas, much to the detriment of Israel's security. So I just don't think it's coherent to announce a get-tough strategy in Iran, and then to walk away from our allies in Iraq and allow Iran to create this corridor to resupply the most heinous terrorist groups like Hezbollah and Hamas. So when you add that to the other items that I put into the strategically incoherent category, it makes me deeply worried about U.S. national security, our relations with allies, and what's going to happen with the Iran nuclear accord. We may not like the deal, but it's the deal that we got. So are we going to throw it under the bus, or are we going to try to make it work? I'll leave that as a question for Danielle to respond to.
No, we don't agree. This was a complete switch and bait. This is not a debate at all. And in fact, David and I agree on lots of issues. And when we originally talked about this, in fact, the person who was going to be playing you, is somebody who I would disagree with a lot more, because it was somebody in the Obama administration who was a big defender of the deal. Those people are now fewer and further between. So how can we make this interesting, since we agree about a lot of the things that David just laid out? God only knows. I'll do my best. That's your job. I'll try for a few minutes first to talk about some things that I think are worthy of consideration. The first is something that I actually laid out in the previous debate that I had here at Columbia. Apparently, I only have two talking points, so I'm going to reiterate them. One of the things, and I mentioned this to David before we started talking, one of the problems with the JCPOA is that it is a deal that the Obama administration and its supporters argue has stopped Iran's path towards a bomb. Okay? And I think that they can, I think that they can make a temporary, not highly persuasive, but certainly, holds water argument that the deal is better than the alternative. And actually, I don't entirely agree with David that things were going just swimmingly before the deal was done, and that we could have continued on that path endlessly. And that's something for people who care about international relations to think about. You know, we have a tendency to look back and say, right, well, we shouldn't have done that because the status quo was fine, assuming that the status quo would always stay the status quo, which, you know, by definition, it sort of doesn't. But, you know, set that aside for a moment. The argument that everybody made, myself included, that all the people who were most concerned about Iran's inexorable progress towards a nuclear weapons capability was very simple. Iran is racing towards the bomb. How many times have we heard this? When I started on Capitol Hill, before many of you, but thank God not all of you, were born, one of the first bills that that was passed when I was up there was the Iran-Iraq Non-Proliferation Act. This was pointed at Saddam Hussein. His missile efforts, but also his nuclear efforts, and at Iran, which was then ramping up towards a nuclear program, but had also been very aggressively and rather fruitfully pursuing missile cooperation with the Russians and the Chinese and others. And this was the argument that everybody made. And so it should not come as a surprise to us that if that is the argument that you construct, then people who have a different worldview, in this case, the President of the United States, who came in with this construct in his mind that America had made a mistake, lo, these 50 years since the end of World War II, 60 years, 70 years since the end of World War II, in fashioning our policy in the Middle East around the Sunnis. And that the Sunnis really kind of suck. The Saudis are unreliable, look at them, you know, the Emiratis, things aren't going well, look at what they did, Al Qaeda, blah, blah, blah. Why don't we work through the Iranians here? What's wrong with that? Why not make an effort? Not just the sort of the backlash to the Iraq war and the Bush administration, but the backlash to what had been American foreign policy for more than half a century, which is let's have a policy that looks at the region through Tehran rather than one that looks at the region through Riyadh. Okay, so Iran is moving towards a bomb, and we should try a different approach. If that is your argument, and I would say that had been our argument, then the JCPOA is not an unreasonable response. Iran is racing towards a bomb, and now we stop them. Yeah, in 10 years, they'll still get a bomb. But, you know, that would be 10 years. And in the meantime, the president and his allies argued, and this is where you said this out, I think, very nicely. In the meantime, there would be this transformation in Iran, this change, because they saw that we had the outstretched hand and whatever else bullshit people like to hear about foreign policy, this would all be good and things would change. And that, of course, was completely untrue, and we've seen that in the last 3 years, because things have been gone in exactly the other direction. The biggest problem is that the argument we made was probably wrong. Okay? Iran was not interested in being North Korea or Pakistan. Iran was interested in being Japan. Okay? Now think about it that way. If we can talk a little bit about, and we should do that afterwards, we can talk a little bit about the nuclear non-proliferation treaty and the flaws in the NPT. Because the flaws in the NPT, in fact, really do enable signatories to work towards being Japan. They shouldn't, but it does. What it doesn't allow is that breakout, right? Where you actually decide that you want to test a nuclear weapon, or you want to test nuclear devices, or you want to do the kinds of things that Iran did. But in fact, the NPT does really, within its constraints, allow a country that is a signatory to do quite a lot of stuff that advances its interests, not simply in a peaceful nuclear program, but in a nuclear weapons program. And if Iran wanted to be Japan, okay, and just to lay it out simply, although I'm sure you all understand perfectly what this means, is that Iran, that Ayatollah Khamenei did not want to be a little bearded rocket man, but he wanted, in fact, to be a man whose country could, at a certain moment, decide that within a very short period of time, it could have not just a nuclear weapon, but an arsenal of nuclear weapons. And unfortunately, the biggest flaw in the JCPOA is that it sets Iran up in 10 to 15 years to be that Japan. And that is, I think, the argument that holds the most water, and the one that, in fact, even proponents of the deal would suggest is rather worrisome. Again, not so worrisome if Iran had gone on the path that the president suggested, that they were really all going to become nicey nice, that things weren't going to be bad, and, you know, that they weren't going to react to our aggression. I'm not quite sure what's going on. There we go, sorry. So that is a big problem with the JCPOA. What is another big problem? So if I lay out how we talked about it, how we constructed arguments. Now, in some sense, you go on foreign policy autopilot, and this is, you know, you have a very path-dependent way of talking about it, a way of legislating, then you end up with this problem. Okay, so then you end up with the backlash to the problem, and this is the Donald Trump problem. This is the, you know, that was a lousy deal. It was, you had all the great quotes, the worst loser deal made by a loser president ever. Yeah, okay. That's really great, but it's not a terribly helpful or constructive argument. As you rightly said, it certainly isn't a strategy. And here is where, actually, I think that you left out some information, which is important. And I wasn't on my phone looking at my Facebook page while you were speaking. I was looking up the exact quote for what is wrong with this. And I had a piece in the New York Times a week before the president refused to certify. Let's step back a second. Congress did not like the JCPOA, and it was a purely partisan decision on the part of a number of Democrats to not vote against it and to support the idea that the president would go forward with it. And we can argue about whether they did the right thing or they didn't do the right thing, or whether it was a treaty or not, but that ship has frankly sailed. But INARA, or what is called Corker Cardin, which is the certification that the president refused to sign in October, has nothing to do with the Iran deal. Okay? And this is a little bit of part that I think people fail to understand. INARA is about the relationship between the executive branch and the Congress. Okay? It is not about the Iran deal. Now, you can ask more about that, but let me just explain in brief. Okay? What it says is, you, the president, whoever you might be, have to certify every quarter, every 90 days, that Iran is in compliance with the terms of the JCPOA. And then, what? Well, then if you don't certify, available to the members of Congress are what are called expedited procedures. So you don't have to introduce a bill, and then it goes through the committee, and then it comes down to the floor, and then you worry about floor time. No, no, no. This can go directly to the floor of the House or the Senate, and it can be considered. Okay, well, that's fine. But that's all. That's all it does. And almost nobody understands this or wants to understand this, including the President of the United States. That is not operative in terms of U.S. compliance with the deal. And the president's failure to certify does not speak to the United States' participation in the deal. If you want to know what the United States' participation in the deal is, go and look in the JCPOA at the annex that lists all the pieces of legislation that will no longer be implemented, all the waivers the president has to put in place, and all the executive orders that the president has to rescind. And I would point out that in that regard, the policy of the Trump administration has been exactly the same as the policy of the Obama administration. Not a single executive order that was rescinded has been put back in place. Okay? Not a single waiver that was exercised exercised during the Obama administration has not been exercised during the Trump administration. And there is another waiver that is due in the beginning of January. And my guess is that that waiver is going to be issued. So in fact, the United States will remain within the terms of the deal that was signed with the Iranians. But Donald Trump is satisfied because he said that Iran wasn't in compliance, and now that's kind of a done deal. And now it's over to Congress, and what should Congress do? No one's quite sure. Congress is considering a number of options, but most of those options will not be dispositive towards the U.S. participation in the deal. Now, what is actually wrong? Let's just take one moment and talk about what's wrong with the deal. there's a lot wrong with the deal, and I talked about putting Iran on a pathway towards a breakout and the capacity to have multiple nuclear, really a nuclear arsenal. That's a big problem. Obviously, we know what the problem is with Iran's missile capability, because we've seen the Iranians test more and more capable missiles in contravention of what we believe was an agreement made under United Nations Security Council resolution, but which the Iranians do not believe. It constrains them. And by the way, the Russians and the Chinese are perfectly happy to back them up on that, which is another problem in doing multilateral agreements with the United Nations. But that's a different argument, and one that we could actually probably have rather enjoyable instead. But here's my favorite quote from Yukio Amano. Okay? So section T of the JCPOA says, that the IAEA, it says that Iran should not be engaging in quote activities which could contribute to the design and development of a nuclear explosive device. But we all agree that's pretty central, right, to the question. Yukio Amano has said, I cannot verify that Iran is not engaging in activities that contribute to the design and development of a nuclear explosive device. To my mind, the notion that Iran is in full compliance with the terms of the deal, but that the Secretary General of the International Atomic Energy Agency cannot certify that, seems to be rather a problem, and should cause an amount of cognitive dissonance, but doesn't, because the Russians have said that the deal is written in a way that gives the IAEA no purview to certify whether, in fact, the Iranians are engaging in activities which could contribute to the design and development of a nuclear explosive device. Add that to the fact that the IAEA does not have access to the main facility where the Iranians conduct this activity, and we know they conduct this activity, which is at the Parchin military complex, and you kind of have a big black hole in what is meant to be this beautiful deal to save us all from the Iranian bomb. So that's just to pick one piece of it that's really not good. Now, what I believe is the biggest, and I'll close here because we should let you into the conversation and be able to the conversation as well, is that it is the strategy piece. It is that one of the arguments that many of us made against the JCPOA, not simply on the terms of the JCPOA itself, but on the knock-on effects that would have in the region, was that it would liberate Iran and help finance Iran to greater and greater adventurism in the Middle East. And what have we seen in the last 3 years? Iran has stepped up its activities in Syria. Iran has stepped up its activities in Iraq. Iran has stepped up its activities in Yemen, and the quality and quantity of weaponry that the Iranians are providing to the Houthis in Yemen is rather troubling if you go by the missile that almost hit Riyadh Airport that was shot down, but that was shot from Yemen. They have stepped up their activities in Bahrain. They have renewed aggressively their support for Hezbollah. They have created the land corridor that you mentioned, and more and more and more. And they have done so with a sense of impunity. And frankly, the Trump administration has done very little to push back on that, much in the same fashion that the Obama administration, which promised and reassured our Arab allies and our Israeli allies that they would push back on that, and didn't. I would say the Trump administration has done more, but not enough. What this has meant is that Iran is, to quote Donald Trump briefly, really winning. Winning so much that they really should be sick of winning. That they are hashtag winning everywhere. And another big part of this, and this, and I promise that's the last thing, it's not the last thing, this is the last thing. It's like a Monty Python routine, I'm sorry. The last point I would make is that I started this entire little disquisition talking about rhetoric and how you build an argument. Okay? Another big problem is that because the Obama administration orientated itself so strongly in reaction to what it perceived was the mistaken construct of American Middle East policy for half a century, what the Trump administration has done is said, you know what, Barack Obama, so wrong about everything, so bad about everything, and not only that, but we're going to swing entirely the other way. But worse yet, we really don't care about these countries too much. They've got a hell of a lot of problems that don't really affect us. And so we're going to subcontract this to our pals in Riyadh and in Abu Dhabi, and we're going to let them manage it all for us. And this is this reaction that we've seen by the Trump administration, which has basically put U.S. policy in the hands of Mohammed bin Salman in Riyadh and Mohammed bin Zayed in the United Arab Emirates. And the result of that has also been to benefit Iran, which is staggering. So you want to talk about a lack of a strategy. Let's say it's not only a lack of a strategy, but it is a self-defeating set of choices that have put us in an even more invidious position vis-a-vis Iran than we would have been had we not done this. And I'll leave it at this joyful thing at that.
Let's get into the time machine back into 2009, since both of you have addressed this, right? What would suggest that the Obama administration, that the status quo was actually unsustainable, that continuing to go down the path that was happening in 2009, 2010 would not have worked? What were some of the problems that were happening at that time, and what would you have recommended that the Obama administration do to address those challenges?
A lot of the arguments that we now all make ex post facto are sort of painful and have been heard. So, first of all, in 2009, when the Obama administration came in, it's important to remember that notwithstanding insistence to the contrary by the administration, they opposed more sanctions on Iran. So the sanctions that were in place on Iran weren't that great at that point. Remember sanctions that bite. She had some expression that was repeated consistently. We've all forgotten everything about Hillary Clinton. But at that point, we had sanctions in place that weren't terribly good. And so Congress was really focused on a series of sanctions that were going to be much more biting. The Bush administration had been a pioneer in that regard because they had finally understood that sanctions on national security matters weren't actually that effective, but financial sanctions would take the crap out of countries. And this is what Stuart Levy, who was the Undersecretary of Treasury, really pioneered enormously effectively. Suddenly, no one wanted to do business in Iran. And that was actually what ended up fighting really hard, and what I suspect helped bring them to the table and help them put them in a position with David Atline, which is that they thought that we'll be able to engineer a deal that actually, I think they needed that as well. What should we have done instead, though? Honestly, you have to say, what are sanctions for? There's a sense in Washington, and we've become rather lazy about this, that sanctions are just there to punish people. You stink. Well, let's slap sanctions on them. Putin, he's a terrible guy. Well, let's sanction them. No, sanctions are intended to change behavior. And if you want to have punishing sanctions, they were always intended to get Iran to stop doing what it was doing and by its very nature, get them to the table. Okay, so they were gotten to the table, and I would say that we had our foot on their throat. Okay, we had the Chinese signed up, we had the Russians signed up, we had the Europeans signed up. They were under substantial sanctions. Okay, and then they came to the table, and John Kerry, as he rightly described, said, "Oh my God, Javad, you're so good looking. What can I give you?" And that's what we did wrong. We actually negotiated a lousy deal. That's the problem.
Just to amplify it, at the time, Stewart's innovation was secondary sanctions.
Right.
And that was really put the pressure on Iran. You asked what was going on at the time? Iraq, where we have committed an enormous number of troops and treasure, was in a full-blown civil war. We were just implementing a surge. We were supporting the Brothers of Iraq, Sunni sheikhs and tribal groups, to oppose the government of Nouri al-Maliki, who was the puppet of Iran. So at that time, the number one foreign policy issue for the United States was dealing with Iraq, and based on his campaign pledge to withdraw the United States from Iraq, to find some kind of a face-saving status quo that would allow the United States to cancel its status of forces agreement and pull its troops out. So a lot of the approach to Iran, I think, was really defined by events in Iraq and the sectarian civil war that was at a full throttle when the Obama administration came into power.
What would Ms. Plugger, you suggested that the problem, that the sanctions did what they needed to do, which was to bring the Iranians to the negotiating table. The problem was with the deal that came out of that. What would a better deal have looked like, and what realistically would Iran have accepted?
Hey, it's a very fair question, and you know, part of the reason why it's become embarrassing to say there should have been a better deal is because a lot of what is laid down as the ideal deal, it seems like a deal that Iran wouldn't have signed up to. And I think that the short answer is that where we started on this, just to digress for a quick second, at a certain point I did a presentation and I went back and looked at what our and the Israeli red lines were on Iran, starting back in the 1990s, and Iran was not intended to be allowed to convert uranium hexafluoride. Let alone put them into an advanced centrifuge and start stockpiling. So our red line shifted and shifted and shifted. And one of the things that we ought to have done is shifted back. Forget Iran for a second. And remember, as you rightly said, North Korea, you know, looks at Iran, Iran looks at North Korea, and Libya. You know, everybody looks at that deal and says to themselves, why should I comply with an NPT? That's stupid. You'll just pay me off to do what I want to do, and then I'll give you a little something. So we should have pushed back a lot harder. We should have forced Iran into very strict compliance with the NPT. In fact, I think it would have been very difficult for the Europeans and the Russians and the Chinese to suggest that they couldn't, because they are signatories to the NPT. I think we should have made a much more aggressive argument about the non-proliferation treaty and the fact that it was being undermined. I think that would have been, again, very hard. I think we should have never allowed the Iranians to create a concept of a peaceful program and a military program, and that they had a military program that was allowed to be off limits to the IAEA. This is an appalling idea. India, which, you know, for a variety of reasons we're less concerned about, and is not a signatory to the NPT, has this notion that there are peaceful sites and military sites, and one's okay to inspect the safeguards, and the other's off limits to everybody. Okay? But they don't have a government that's supporting terrorism all over the place, American soldiers, wherever they happen to be. So, you know, again, all of those things, I think, were certainly, if not perfectly achievable, much more achievable. I think we never needed to give away the ban on conventional weapons, which frankly the Iranians asked for at the last minute and never thought they were going to get. Okay? I think we should have given much less on ballistic missile testing. And all of those things I think were achievable. This is not, you know, let us humiliate you and grind you into the dirt and you need to put up the Israeli flag and tear on. These are things that were actually achievable.
The major problem had to do with the sunset clauses. The Obama administration was so keen to get a deal that they looked at the 10 to 15 year windows. So we can live with that because in the short term, our needs are going to be addressed. The concept of the sunset clause, full stop, was a flawed negotiating tactic. If we were going to negotiate an end to Iran's nuclear pathway, that should have been full and final. One of the things that Trump wants to do now is to change the terms of the sunset clauses. But once they are locked into agreement, you're definitely not going to be able to move the calendar back by a decade or two. And more broadly, we were concerned not just about Iran's nuclear program, we were concerned about Iran's support for terrorism.
Absolutely.
It wasn't even on the table. Because we concluded from the beginning that we wanted to focus only on Iran's nuclear program, and that if we overburden the negotiations with support for terrorism or its ballistic missile program, that was a deal breaker. And that's probably correct. If we had insisted on those, then Iran probably would have just walked away. I think as a negotiating tactic, we could have raised those as concerns, given them up, and then extended the sunset clauses by a considerable amount of time.
Let me ask about the sunset clauses, because it wasn't part of the logic. Wouldn't it be possible to imagine a scenario in which, and this is play devil's advocate, right, in which a breeding goat, let's assume that Iran persisted in exactly what it's doing today. Is there a possibility that those sunset clauses could be renegotiated at a later point that would extend them and then extend them in ways that would virtually render them moot?
It's possible. Is it plausible or likely? And I think the answer to that is no. Iran clearly built into the deal a terminus where they could then make a decision, a strategic choice, about whether they want to restart their program or weaponize their program. And the deal essentially gave them a legal path to do that. Why would Iran, at the end of the deal, suddenly have an aha moment and change its posture towards its nuclear program in the United States and international community? So those were flaws. Those were structural and strategic flaws that were built into the deal. They should never have been there. And we're now looking at a 12-year period where Iran is going to be able to hit the switch and go back to business as usual. What leverage will we have over Iran at that point, especially after they've had sanctions lifted and they're exporting oil and had $150 billion infusion into their economy? We surrendered our leverage. And when we started the negotiation, and I saw that John Kerry and Wendy Sherman were in charge, I thought to myself, we are heading for a train wreck. As long as Bill Burns was there, I knew there was a grown-up in the room who knew about international diplomacy. The Obama political appointees were so desperate to advance this goal of bringing rogue regimes in from the cold that they gave away much too much on Iran because they didn't want the negotiation to fall apart on their watch.
I'll tell you something interesting, actually. The Iran deal came on. We talked about it as a P5+1. But for a long time during the Bush administration, it was the EU3+3 that we talked about. And at that point, the Bush administration made a push towards trying to do negotiations with the Iranians as well, particularly towards the end of the administration. And what was really fascinating to see was the transformation of these groups. Why was it that a group that had been pretty jaundiced about what the Iranians were up to were suddenly game to start giving up the score as they did? It wasn't just that Wendy Sherman and John Kerry took over, because that's not what we said. What happened was that in the case of every single delegation, the Iran nuclear file had been in the hands of the nuclear specialists. So, we have a bureau at the Department of State that deals with nuclear proliferation, right? That's the MIT Bureau. It is the Assistant Secretary for International Security and Non-Proliferation. Those were the guys who dealt with everybody's nuclear programs, Pakistan, everything. And the same was true among all of our allies. I don't want to talk about Russia and China because that's different. By the time the JCPOA was signed, the only delegation that was a non-proliferation delegation that came from that part and not from what's called the regional bureau, the people that deal with the Middle East, who are traditionally much less hard-nosed on this question of the NPT and of adherence to various non-proliferation standards, the only delegation that continued to be that was the French. And the French government opposed that deal very strongly, and to the end, in fact, and finally made a strategic decision in Paris that they could not stand the Obama administration any further, and so they went along with it, but they thought it was a terrible deal. It was kind of an interesting, just a little inside politics, you know, that how those things happen.
So I said in my remarks that it's the deal that we have. What are we going to do to try to make it work? When you look at Iran's record over the past several years, and particularly more recently, they have been troublemaking everywhere they can. I think there's a hypothetical question to be asked. If the rhetoric coming from the Trump administration warrants so confrontational, would Iran adjust its behavior in the region? Are they reacting to Trump's confrontational tone and the substance of remarks, or is this just ingrained in Iran's DNA?
There's absolutely no credible case to be made that the Iranians are reacting to Trump. To the contrary, the Iranian behavior that we see now is a straight line trajectory from the behavior that began before the JCPOA, but since the signing of the JCPOA has been exacerbated throughout the region.
So that may very well be true. I'm not going to dispute it. When we talk about the spirit of the accord, Iran has clearly defied the spirit of the accord in many instances. But by castigating Iran, hasn't the U.S. also undermined the spirit of the accord? And if we're playing a long game, and this is a bet, and we want Iran to somehow wake up and be more conciliatory, is the way that we're approaching Iran now during the Trump administration conducive to that goal, or does it make it less likely?
If they were going to be conciliatory, would they not have done so during the 2 years of Chamberlain-esque foreign policy in the Obama administration?
Well, 12 years is a long time in diplomacy. But we don't know what Iran is going to look like.
No, but this is the position of a husband being caught having an affair, and when his wife nails him on it, he says, you know, how dare you? You know, you're just making things worse by nailing me for this. I'm sorry, what? The Iranians are up to this, and this is what they're up to. The notion that they are bad guys because Donald Trump is an idiot does not hold water.
So we agree that they're bad guys.
They do.
I think we also agree that Donald Trump is an idiot.
The causality there is just not there.
But it's a hypothetical because
they
don't
just
know.
Get satisfaction out of calling Donald Trump.
I've been waiting for that moment.
I know, everybody has.
And we even agreed on it, which is even more remarkable.
Well, I think the nicer version of what we call the current administration's foreign policy in this region is incoherent. So let's try and put in some coherence. All right. So if you and then before that, I'll open it up. I'll ask one more question and then open it up to questions from the audience. So we're running low on time, but just keep your questions brief. What would you recommend, given that this deal is in place right now? Maybe you recommend that Europe would scrap it up. But what would you recommend for Iran, the United States' position in Iran, given what we believe, I don't know what the actual objectives are, but I think the strategy should flow from its objectives. So what is the U.S. objective? What should be the strategy? And how do you sell it to a public that is very clearly against, or at least a sizable part of the public that's against engagement of the kind of deep interventions we saw in the first decades?
So the president should just shut up and stop tweeting about it. He should let the IAEA inspectors do their work. He can hide behind the other signatories to the deal and use that as leverage. Unless we want to scuttle the deal and we want Iran to withdraw, which has strategic implications in the region, which will ramify in North Korea, if we want it to work, then there's a way of doing it by following the roadmap that was agreed. That roadmap is imperfect and it's windy and there are a lot of bumps in the road, but there's clearly a process there. I'm just not sure that there's an alternative that works better. And we know that if the deal falls apart, that there's no military solution to the problem. That Iran's program is urbanized, it's bunkerized. We're not going to be able to deal with Iran's nuclear potential through military action. So there needs to be a question, what's the plan B? Is military action really a viable alternative?
I'm not quite sure what you said, but the strategy that's correct.
We've agreed on everything so far.
I know, but I'm actually not sure what you said. I wasn't just being mean. I think that the right approach is pretty straightforward. And that is that the deal is the deal, and we should not lie to ourselves. That I agree with that. And we should not lie to ourselves that somehow there is in the offing some better deal that the Iranians are just going to come to because they believe that Donald Trump is a bigger man than Barack Obama. But we do have enormous leverage over the Iranians, and the notion that we have lost all that leverage is, to coin a phrase, rubbish. First of all, we should actually have the strategy that the president that signed the JCPOA and the president who was elected said that they were going to pursue, which is one of curtailing Iran's ability to move in the region. That means pushing back extremely hard in Syria. That means pushing back extremely hard in Iraq. That means curtailing Iran's ability to export its weaponry. It means curtailing their, it means making them pay a heavy price for their intervention in Yemen. It means making them pay a heavier price for what they're doing in Bahrain. It means stopping them from transferring assistance to Hamas and Hezbollah. How do you do those things? Some of them require more troops on the ground than we have. Some of them actually require us to pursue financial sanctions that I think our allies are perfectly prepared to sign up to, and I will give Donald Trump a little credit here. Our allies are very worried about what the United States is going to do, and they are very willing to do more to constrain Iran in areas outside the nuclear file. And they have said so directly to the president and to others. The question is what? And what we need to do is that we need to pursue this aggressively, concertedly, publicly, so that the Iranians are aware of this. I mean, just to leaven this with another anecdote about what, you know, what happens. French foreign ministry folks were in Tehran last month, and so they came and we were sitting chatting in Washington, and they said, you know, what's ironic is that we see the exact opposite messages in Tehran and Washington. In Washington, everybody says, well, we kind of need to live with the JCPOA because it is the deal that we have, but we need to press on Iran and all their other activities, okay? Which is what I just laid out, but not through tactics, but actually through a concerted strategy with follow-through, et cetera, which is what we're lacking in this administration. In Tehran, he said, their message to us was, yeah, you know, we recognize there's some stuff about the JCPOA you don't like, and we can probably give a little on that because they're feeling pretty good. But if you try and interfere with our regional activities, that is completely unacceptable, off limits, don't do it. Okay. So exactly the opposite. And you know, what does this tell us? This tells us that we actually have some leverage. First of all, we can lean on them regionally. And there are lots of ways, by the way, other than military intervention, one of the biggest disservices that Barack Obama did to the entire notion of foreign policy is the notion that there are only two options in foreign policy. 500,000 troops on the ground or do nothing. Right? Endless war or appeasement. And the answer is no. We may have a crappy Department of State and an outgoing Secretary of State, but we've got an entire Department of State, we've got an entire military whose job is deterrence, not war. Right? We've got all of these tools available to us. We can help the Iraqis much more than we have. They want that help. It will oust the Iranians. We could do a lot more in this regard. The problem for us is that we seem incapable of thinking beyond the end of our nose. And that is a problem that is not just Donald Trump. That is a, you know, an American ADD problem that has developed over the last couple of decades, and I don't know how we get away from it.
So I think in fairness, it was Colin Powell who coined the overwhelming use of force. So it's not something that was unique to the Obama administration. And in each of the different areas that you touched on, Danielle, the regional issues, you and I are in lockstep. There's much more that we can do and we should do, especially in Iraq, where we have made such an investment. And to surrender Iraq to a government in Baghdad, which is a proxy for Iran, to me,
I don't agree with you at all. We're not going down this road. Okay.
We'll have to save that for another hour.
Not at all.
But to surrender to Iranian influence in Iraq, to Iran's role in Syria, where Russia is another topic for discussion, but to allow Iran to get away with that and not push back strongly, to me is abrogation of our values and our fundamental obligations, particularly after having gone to war. And people went to war with us, and we basically surrendered them to a regime in Baghdad and Hashim al-Shabi's militias who are acting directly against Iraq's national interests and ours. So there's much more that we should do. We agree that should be done. I'm not sure that would affect the nuclear file. Your question was really, what do we do to try to make the nuclear file stronger?
I think the Iranians would give on that if they thought that they were being constrained in other areas. But, you know, I mean, we're on a test of that. We should let the audience have some questions.
So let me just respond to that. You know, Zarif and I know each other well. You know, every time that he and I sat together, there were dozens of times, he talked to me about Persian pride and how they would react if they felt that they were being harassed into something. Maybe he was just spinning me, but I took away from those meetings that it really meant something to the Iranians, and if we pushed them into a corner, we could make things worse.
So on that note, I'm going to collect questions from the audience. So what that means is that I'll call on about two or three of you at a time. I'm going to ask that you introduce yourselves and be very brief. Actually ask a question, and please make sure that we give our panelists time to respond. I will exercise my nuclear option if you start to talk. All right, so does anybody have any questions they'd like to pose? If not, I'll be there. And
we have many more questions than we have time.
So one, two,
three. Okay. Hi, Hudson Pierce. Both of you mentioned how we could have gotten more in the past and we should work towards getting more from Iran. But the way I see it is, wouldn't you say the kind of sweet spot for doing that has gotten worse? For one, U.S. soft power is, you know, maybe at an all-time low with Trump, the drunk in Paris deal and all that. And then two, we've seen somewhat of a rebound in the price of oil and all that, given the strength back to Iran. So do we have that lever that you talked about to get more at this point?
Is it a good thing that allies seem to be back off, allies or still allies, and seem to be banding together, for example, with Saudi Arabia in the event of
Hi there, I'm Hunter Stiers. I'm a junior here at Columbia, also a fellow at the Hadlor Center for Naval War College, and I do some work at the Center for the National Interest in their Defense Studies program. I'd like to ask you a question that sort of broadens the context a little bit about the role of China and bring in Chinese ambitions in Central Asia, the One Belt, One Road, their attempts to essentially establish a more continental world order that can include, that is, you know, where Iran plays a significant role. Could you speak to this particular relationship and its component of the situation?
So I'll let Daniel address the question on China's role. Can we just talk about unilateral U.S. action versus multilateralism? And that gets right to the core of what makes the U.S. an effective actor in the world. Is it going it alone? Is it our way or the highway? Is it working through this web of agreements and multilateral strategies and international law to achieve our goals? I have no problem with America first. I just believe that America first is best achieved by working through international cooperation and multilateral frameworks. So I think we can do both. Not being too exclusive. That's something that we should be thinking about and researching and writing about.
I'll try and be succinct and fair, and I'm also going to avoid your question as long as I can. Because it was just a hard and complicated question, and I'm not sure I can do justice to it. So, no soft power, power support, you know, I'm sorry. I think that's just fuzzy thinking about the world. The problem for us is not execution, but the problem for us is strategy. And that's what you heard from both of us. The United States does well when it has a vision. And when we seek to unify our allies behind that vision, we are stronger, although we're pretty strong without them too. The problem for us is that that vision is lacking, that imagination is lacking, and because of that, we have not worked hard to have the tools that are available to do the things we need to do. Could we? Of course we could. We're the richest country in the world. We have the finest military in the world. We have a pretty decent group of diplomats, and we got a bunch of cash to play with and a lot of influence.
What's left of
our problem? The poor guys that are left are they're all with Exxon, no less you know. But you can't do it without the will, and I would say without the moral underpinnings and understanding of where you're going. So that's my answer to that, and we can talk more afterwards. Your question is a very fascinating one, and it is something that we've talked about an awful lot. And this is the sort of the byproduct of the backlash, the Iran backlash, which is the one single unifying idea of the Sunni and Israeli world, which is Obama was awful. I've been in Riyadh, I've been in Beirut, I've been in Jerusalem, I've been in Abu Dhabi, I've been in Baghdad. I've been around over the last 6 months, everywhere I've met with the leadership is the same. He was the worst ever. Look what he did with Iran. And okay, thanks guys. The problem is that their vision, and I include the Israelis in this, is very short term. Okay? And this is what we see in Yemen, and this is what we see in Lebanon, and this is what we see here with the Hariri episode. It's like, okay, are you thinking beyond these three moves? Because, that's going to be a problem otherwise. And so while it's great that they have these newfound tactical alliances, I'm not sure how deep they are, and I'm not sure that they are actually going to be, on balance, advantageous to us, even though it feels great to see, a Saudi visiting Jerusalem, that's cool and massive, after so many years of not seeing that. On One Belt, One Road, very quickly, and China's vision, I can only parrot what our director of Asian Studies says, because I, as I was telling you before, know not too much about China and foreign policy. What I will say is, what does Iran have in common with China and with Russia? These are revisionist powers. These are powers that are looking toward the future and thinking of themselves as empires. And this is a big inflection point in foreign policy. This is the big nerdy think tank work that we are doing. We have a book coming out on this, actually. I think that the Chinese are much more circumscribed in their ambitions right now. I think where the Russians have been willing to kind of pick off the low-hanging fruit, despite their financial constraints, and I would say their military constraints, that this is a much more of a domestic policy strategy for Putin. He's got an election next year. It's, hey, look over there. Look how well we're doing. Rather than a long-term strategic view. And it is the weakness of both the Obama and the Trump administrations that we've allowed the Russians to exploit it. I think the Chinese site is still focused, as far as it goes in the Muslim world, it's in Central Asia. They're still very focused on the South China Sea. I think they're very content to watch the Middle East kind of spiral and, take some advantage where they can, but I don't think that they have a big conservative strategy. The one thing I would say about China that's very interesting is their huge and disproportionate investment in Israel. There's a big article in the Financial Times last week. They are one of the single largest foreign direct investors in Israel. And I wish I understood better what they were up to. I know they're stealing technology, and that's a good thing for them, but I don't know what else it is they're up to there, so I don't quite understand that. So that's the best I can do for you.
Let me just put it as a question. Is our return to Sunni alliances based on our goal to sell weapons to them? The treasury under the $100 billion shopping bazaar. So is it based on strategy and security, or is it just about selling U.S. made goods?
I'm going to get two more questions here and then there. questions?
He's going to shut you down if you talk too much.
From diaspora, I am 1 year in New York, so I believe Dr. Bill was very high up and has all this time very insisted that it was not very politics, this one, and made Iran more power than ever, and that fact has a very cost for human rights in this country, in outside in European country, Iran. Has a very friend and they working for persecution. I am example for this one. So I did not question just that this creeping is a this side with the AC and how I do with this nuclear thing, which is not
I got it turned to.
Yes, okay.
But did you want to finish one thought?
I wanted only to message the nuclear level of
sure,
so romantic and so great.
Yes, hello. Well, first of all, I would like to thank you for coming here, but I must say this was a little bit disappointing in that I could hardly tell who was the pro and who was the con half the time. And I think that speaks to the very truncated nature of acceptable opinions within American policy establishment. But now on to my question. Here's one out of left field. What exactly is...
I think we got one... I asked for one question, right?
That wasn't the question, that was a comment.
But, no, that's why I asked for a question, though, right? We have one more back there.
Can you hear me on the microphone?
Yes. Quickly.
So I think something that hasn't been discussed is we've been discussing what happened in 2009, what was wrong. We're discussing right now what we can do right now. But can we discuss very briefly, let's say worst comes to worst, or what seems to be inevitable happens, Iran gets the nuclear weapons. Because we have 3 or 7 years of incoherent policy, and Iran succeeds. What do we do? What happened? What is this going to be?
I'm sorry, may I have my question, please?
You can ask it afterwards, because I asked for questions, right?
Yes, very quick.
Go ahead, then.
All right, here's one out of left field. Just challenging some common assumptions. What exactly is so bad about Iran having nuclear weapons in the first place?
So we're running out of time, but let me see if I can answer your question. I'm not sure that we'll end up having to do anything. I think Israel will take matters into its own hands. Iran with a nuclear weapon represents an existential threat to Israel. I don't think that they will allow that to happen. And I don't think they would ask for permission before they launched a preemptive strike.
Yes,
fine. Can you respond to any of the other parts?
Who's the pro and who's the con?
What would
the problem? I think that should have sailed for Israel. I think Iran is, the Israelis talked about having a zone of immunity that Ehud Barak described in 2005 or something like that. Iran is soon entering the zone of immunity. I think Iran has entered the zone of immunity. And the problem is they have the expertise, and I think the Israelis had an option to act, and they chose not to. And I don't know what we're going to do, but the bigger question I think that we should think about is what have we done in other cases? And what you would say to yourself if you were Iran is, nothing, we've done nothing. We've done nothing when North Korea got a nuclear weapon, or two, or three, or a delivery device. We did nothing when Pakistan got a nuclear weapon, or two, or three, or 100, and the delivery device. We were a lot of talk. The Israelis have acted on two occasions in Syria and in Iraq, and those actions were both at the inception of a nuclear weapons program, not at the end. I'd be very curious to see that plan.
I think in answer to the last question, if Iran did develop a nuclear weapon, but it wasn't malign in its intentions, could we live with it? And that's at the root of your question. I don't have an answer to that, and it's hard for me to envision Iran not being maligned, given its conduct today. But maybe the long game will prove to be a good strategy. Iran will be transformed. Maybe they'll be transformed with or without a nuclear weapon. But it's too soon to tell.
So I think the fact that all of these students are here during finals period is a testament to how both interesting and stimulating I thought this discussion was, and I'm sure that they share this, so please join me in thanking.
And it's totally my fault.
Thank you to our speakers, and thank you guys all for coming out. We have two sign-up sheets going around if you want to join our mailing list. And have a great night. Thank you again.